there's two states, say minus will be approximately equal to say state zero, and plus will be approximately equal to state one, and the energies of these states will be E minus will be basically equal to omega squared over beta, so you can get it by just expanding this expression, and E plus will be given by minus beta minus omega squared over beta. So this, you know, never mind this minus sign, this sort of convention, but basically, what is this? Where does this come from, right? So this comes from the following. So remember I told you that in the presence of the field, what you need to do, you need to basically move this state zero up here, right? And then I end up with the two states, which are now split by the tuning delta, and they are coupled by all the diagonal element, which has a magnitude omega, right? So now, these two levels to begin with are not degenerate. So what we can do, we can just use conventional perturbation theory, right? V is V squared over energy, right, is a conventional perturbation theory, and this is a golden rule, basically, and this is the result. So what will happen to the leading order is that atoms will actually not making much of the transitions between state 0 and 1, but what will happen is that the state 0 will be shifted, will be pulled, you know, down a bit, while the state 1 will be pulled up a little bit, right? And this will result in the phase accumulated over time. So this is a concept of dress states. Any questions? Yeah?
What do you mean by phase accumulated over time, the phase between
so that's a very good question. In this case, you know, if I just start, you know, if I start in a state, you know, zero, then of course it will be, you know, the space makes no difference. But for example, if I start in superposition state of this two, then, you know, this will be a relative phase. Or for instance, if I have another state here, which is not coupled, but if I prefer the superposition state, this light shift, this, you know, AC start shift or light shift, as it's sometimes called, will result in the relative phase accumulated between these two. So this AC start shift or light shift is also the basis for dipole trapping, for optical lattice, right? Because this is basically this is the origin of the light potential on atoms, right, in which the atoms move. Okay, so. So this was the second thing which you need to know. So let me do one more thing, you know, and then we maybe can proceed with lectures if time allows. So, so the third thing. So any other questions? Okay, is it clear? Okay. So this the third thing which I'd like to mention is connected with the dissipation. So far, I basically talked to you about Hamiltonian dynamics. So the third thing that we need to know is related to the concept of optical pumping, which is basically also approximately equivalent to what's called golden rule. The idea is a function. Suppose let's still stick with this two-level system, but let's now consider more realistic case in which the upper state of the system decays. And this decay can be, for example, due to a spontaneous emission or due to some other process. So let's consider the situation where you start in this ground state. The atom starts from state. It's driven either resonantly or resonantly, but now let's try to understand what will happen as a result of this decay. Right? So in the past, you know, we talked about Rydberg oscillations, about atoms going back and forth between these two states. But now the dynamics will be modified. So in particular, let's consider the situation where, for example, gamma is larger than omega. what's going to happen?
Yeah. You don't see any oscillation because it's over down.
Exactly, but so what will happen? What will happen? Will it stay in the ground state or not? Will it stay in the ground state all the time? Probably not, right? Because what will happen is that this coherence field will still try to excite it. Right? But then this kind of coherent Rydberg oscillation will undergo kind of, you know, random dephasing, you know, basically, you know, the phase will be, you know, the phase will build up, you know, but then kind of this decay will change this phase, you know. So this, and this is what's going to happen, right? So the simple way to describe it, this kind of effect, is once again by using kind of something like a perturbation theory, right? So in perturbation theory, what we have done, for example, like, you know, when we talk about AC star shifts, we argue that this AC star shifts can be basically understood from this kind of argument, right, where you have kind of matrix element squared divided by effective energy difference squared. And so what will happen in this case is that, you know, of course, this matrix element is nothing but the square of Rydberg frequency. And then in the denominator, what will happen is that there will be detuning plus minus I gamma. So basically, you can think about this excited state as having some kind of imaginary or complex energy, right? And the real part of this energy will be detuning, right? And the complex part will be given by this decay, right? So this is just kind of like a generalization of this AC star shift type argument, right? And basically, if you go on, what you will find out is that this kind of energy shift to the ground state will now have two parts. It will have the imaginary part, and it will have a real part, and this real part is basically what we already discussed, this AC star shift. It will also have an imaginary part. And so this imaginary part will basically correspond to kind of a finite lifetime, if you want, of an atom in the ground state. So basically what will happen is that if the atom started in the ground state, and due to this combined effect of this excitation field and this decay, it will kind of eventually kind of escape or get excited. And this excitation rate, which I'm going to call R, is basically the rate of excitation out of this ground state, right? So this is, you know, for example, in a case involving, say, this kind of multi-state atoms, this will be the rate of optical pumping, right? So this is the rate in which the feature of the atom started here, it will make a transition to some other state. Right? So this kind of, you know, logic is a basis, for example, for conventional optical pumping. If you shine the light on the gas of atoms, you will polarize these atoms, and this is the rate of polarization if the light is not too strong. So, okay, so are there any questions? Does it make sense? Is there anyone who has not heard, or let's just, is there anyone who has not heard about this concept previously? Okay. So who is familiar with this concept to the point that you've woken up at 3 o'clock after heavy drinking? Okay, so that's a lot. Okay, so now, like, I told you about this free, you know, you can think of what's, you know, guys telling and those three random facts, right? So now let me make a statement and I can back it up. So these three things over past century, you know, and good knowledge and good understanding of this free concept resulted in something like 5 to 10 Nobel Prizes over the last century. So, for example, understanding of subdoppler cooling. The Nobel Prize for laser cooling resulted from a combination of these two things. So once you understand these two things, you can understand how the multi-level atom moves in the field of kind of fields polarized differently, and this is, for example, a result, you know, results in things like Sisyphus effect, right? So this basically plot with and Jean-Rivard explain this very unexpected observation from very simple physical kind of model, which is really based on these two things. Just to give you an example. So this is an opportunity to ask questions. Is everything clear? So are we ready for a break? So what is actually, what's the time kind of, we sort of started in the,
say another 15 minutes.
Okay, good, good. So, any questions? If not, we go on.
So, all right, okay.
So these are basically three things that I have explained, but there are five things that you actually need to know, so there are two more. So, what are these two things? So basically what I'd like to do now is I'd like to kind of move closer to the actual subject of my talk, and this will be a subject involving kind of, you know, interactions between atoms, photons, and photons with photons themselves. And so in order to do that, I'd like to review some very basic physics of interactions between atoms and photons. And once again, if you'd like to read more about it, you can have a look at the chapter 9 of the lecture notes, which I already quoted. So the basic, very basic model for kind of quantum interactions between light and atoms, the simplest possible model, involves the system which have just one bosonic mode, for example, confined in a cavity, with just one two-level atom. So it's the simplest possible symbol which one could ever imagine. So I'd like to kind of review the basic physics of the system now with the eye towards this, you know, three concepts. So what do we need to know? So what's the most basic model which describes this kind of interaction? Does any one of you know? Is it James Cunningham's model? So James Cunningham's model basically describes the exchange of excitation between the bosonic model described by, for example, this creation and annihilation operator A, and the atom. So in this case, the atom has two states, ground and excited. So it's equivalent to 0 and 1. So what is the most important thing in James Cummings' model? It has one parameter, right? It has a parameter which corresponds to the rate of interaction between the atoms and the photons. So it's this coupling constant G, which has this very funny expression, right? So what's this coupling constant? What's it called? So it's basically, well, the physical meaning of this coupling constant is just a Rabi frequency associated with one photon, right? And so this is given by this very funny looking expression. So where does this expression come from? So who can reproduce this expression when woken up at 2 o'clock at night? Okay, so unfortunately that's, you know, life, and this is actually the fourth concept that you need to know. So the fourth concept, which is very important, is the concept of the single photon Rydberg frequency. Also known as G. So how to derive it? So this G has a funny thing, right? So this mu here is a dipole moment. Omega is a frequency, is an optical frequency. This V is an effective mode volume of the cavity. Right? So how can this derive? Where does it come from? How can one derive it in a simple way? So you need to quantize a field, right? So is it possible to do it on a blackboard here? So is there so I'd like to be able to derive it in one line so that I can remember it when I wake up and walk at night. It's not a memory question, right? It's an understanding question. So where does this G come from? Right? So let's consider a situation where I put one photon inside this cavity and I ask a question. What will this one photon do? What will be the Rydberg frequency associated with this one photon? Right? So what's the Rydberg frequency, by the way? So how do you calculate Rydberg frequency? So it's a matrix, it's proportional to matrix element, right? Of transition, if there is no matrix element, there is no. Then what else? It's an electric field, and it's divided by h bar. Right? But now this electric field is a funny quantity, right? This electric field is basically this electric field per photon, right? So we need to find an electric field associated with one photon. How can we do it? Come on, guys. Which relation? Operator has nothing to do with the dimensionless quantity. Creation annihilation operator is a harmonic oscillator. What it has nothing to do with G, right? Harmonic oscillators are everywhere, right? So how to derive the electric field corresponding to one photon? What?
Energy.
Yeah. Right. So what's a single photon energy? Exactly. So now, and how can I express the energy in terms of electric field? What's it? So it's 1/2?
C.
What?
C times epsilon naught. Electric field squared.
So what's C?
Speed of light.
What?
Speed of light.
So, go on. So we need to connect it with electric field, right? Exactly. So basically, so this is energy density in the electric field, right? But you know what we need is energy, right? So we basically need to multiply it by the volume in which this energy is stored, right? Now, actually, there is no C here. And, you know, even this epsilon zero, you know, technically it shouldn't be there, right? It's a kind of, that's an unfortunate choice of CI units, basic units by the humankind, but okay, we will not go into that. So epsilon zero is there. So what about this 1/2, right? Should it be there or not?
Yes.
A little bit subtle question, because the wave has electric energy and magnetic energy, right?
Depends on the field.
What?
Depends on the field. Like, if you quantize carry, you don't need half, but if you quantize the rolling wave, you need half.
Okay, so what's, so it's factors of two, I will forgive you, so it's, you know, let's just erase it, so it's an order of magnitude. Okay, so basically from here, what we find is that E is given by square root of h bar over epsilon zero V, right? And we can now substitute this here, and what we'll get is exactly this thing which was written on the blackboard, right? this is one of the most fundamental, in fact, it's the most fundamental concept in quantum optics involving quantized interaction of light and matter. So, what this expression also tells us is that, in general, you know, if you'd like to make G large, you should make V small, right? V and mu is the only two things which you can play with, right? So, for a given dipole moment, the only thing you can do to increase G is squeeze your photon as much as possible in space. Okay, so this is the essence of James Cunning's model. But then, you know, remember that our kind of situation where we just have one bosonic model and one X-ray bottom is an approximation. So in particular, in optical domain, it almost always happens that the atom can also emit in other modes. And basically, the emission is just given pretty much by a free space atom decay rate. That's gamma. But also then, once you created this photon, it will not stay in a cavity forever. It will eventually leak. That's a cavity decay rate gamma. Now, the question I'd like to ask is that now, what's the combination of these parameters, G and kappa and gamma, under which the photon in the cavity will start feeling the presence of the atom? Or, put in other words, under which conditions will atom start feeling the presence of the cavity? So in order to answer this complicated question, which might, you know, take many pages of algebra, we will make use of our concepts 2 to 4 to derive it in one slide. So, just kind of to set the stage, there are sort of two different regimes which one could look at. One is something which is actually called strong coupling regime, where G is much larger than kappa and gamma. So in this case, what will happen is that you can sort of neglect basically gamma and kappa to the first approximation, so the atom will just undergo this kind of, you know, Rabi oscillations, which will be driven by a single photon, right? It will decay, the photon will decay, and will be later reabsorbed, right? So that's what's going to happen. So a number of excitations is preserved. Actually, for the purposes of today's talk, I'm actually interested much more in this other regime. So in this regime, basically, once, so this kappa, this, you know, is actually very, very fast, right? So once a photon is created, it will really try to leave very, very fast. Nevertheless, you know, even in this regime, you can create the conditions such that the atom decay and atom interactions with photon will be dramatically modified by the cavity. So how can this happen? Let's do the calculation. So let's consider a situation where initially the atom is excited and there are no photons inside the cavity. Right? That's the now initial state. So then, of course, what can happen is that this atom field interaction can actually drive the transition between the state, this initial state, and the state where atom is in the ground state and there is one photon which has been created in the cavity. But once this photon is created, it can decay, of course. Right? So this is now our system. Right? It has this coherent coupling rate, G, and incoherent rate, kappa. So now, what will be the effective dynamics? How can we approximate this kind of dynamics? So what will happen here is basically the atom will leave this excited state, right? Will come here, but it will never go back. So effectively, we can describe this entire process as an effective decay of this excited state. What will be the rate of this decay? When in doubt, check out the four rules that we already learned. Right? So we know what G is. Right? So what we can do now is basically employ this kind of optical pumping rule. Right? So essentially on resonance, what will happen is that effectively this cavity-mediated decay will be given by G squared divided by kappa. Right? It's kind of omega squared divided by gamma, what we've seen before. Right? Now, actually, in general, in more general case, there could be some atom cavity detuning, right? So what will this detuning do?
Change
term in the denominator. It would be kappa squared plus the...
Okay, so what is the tuning will do, kind of, you know, in the presence of G, it will actually shift the position of this upper state, right? Mm-hmm. You know, by the amount, which will be basically G squared over delta, you know, delta is large, right? So, what is this? What's this effect? So it's kind of like AC star shift, right? But now it's an AC star shift by this, you know, quantum field, which initially was not present. So what is, what's the physics? How is it called? What's the physics of this effect? So you place an atom in a cavity, right? So let's make the tuning very, 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 very large, so that there basically are no transitions here. So then the atom will mostly stay in this excited state, right? But this position will be shifted a bit. So what is that? Why is that? How comes? You put an atom in a cavity, cavity is far detuned. But all of a sudden, the levels shift. There is no photons in the cavity. How can this possibly occur? Any ideas? Come on, guys. Just, you know, don't, you know, there are no bad ideas.
Do the vacuum mode?
What does it mean exactly, the vacuum mode? You know, so I mean, it goes in the right direction, you know, but yeah.
So in the adjust state, you have some mixing between the two.
You have a little bit of mixing, but, you know, nevertheless, the result is that, you know, this state somehow just, you know, just moves. So it's actually connected to something which is called lamp shift, right? So lamp shift, as you know, is a shift of the level, you know, which is basically induced by kind of vacuum fluctuations. And the shift basically depends on things like density of states, for example, right? So by putting a cavity around the atom, you modify the density of states. And as a result, you modify the lamp shift. Right? So you've actually heard this already today. Right? So you look at the atom, you know, at atomic energy, and you put a bunch of other atoms around. Right? So these other atoms around somehow modify the environment so that to shift the position of the level. Right? So this is kind of this in the case of Charles, was a collective lamp shift. So here, this is basically a lamp shift modified by the cavity. Right. So basically, you know, okay, so now from this kind of configurations, you know, what we can see is that, you know, we can also find out the conditions under which the cavity actually has any effect. Right. So in particular, what we see here is that the cavity decay, for example, will dominate over the free space decay. So the atom can also decay just by emitting photon, you know, outside of the cavity. But the cavity decay will dominate if this R is much larger than the free space gamma. And so when G squared is much larger than kappa gamma, then the interactions of the atom with the cavity dominate over the free space interaction. Now, by using the definition of this G, and basically also, you know, connecting kappa and gamma also to fundamental constants, we can actually rewrite this condition, G over kappa gamma, either in terms of the mode, volume, and the cavity Q, or in terms of transverse localization of the atom, of the field, like transverse size of the beam D and the cavity finesse. So lambda is a wavelength of lambda. So note that, you know, so this basically up to constant factors, you know, all of these are the same things. So note that dipole matrix element drops out here, right? There is no dipole matrix element. Why is that? That's kind of odd, no? Why does the mu drop out in these expressions? It drops out because G squared is proportional to mu squared, but also gamma, the spontaneous decay in the free space, also proportional to mu squared. So basically, gamma drops out. So this is kind of the physics of this atom-photon interface. So essentially, if you place an atom in a cavity, it can emit in a free space with red gamma. But, you know, due to this interaction with the confined mode, there is new decay channel, and this is a decay channel into the cavity mode, and basically the figure of merit, the most important figure of merit here is the ratio between this cavity decay into the cavity and the free space decay is called cooperativity. So this cooperativity goes like g squared over kappa gamma, and it can be also expressed in terms of this cavity parameters. So basically, we are interested to explore the regime in which the interaction with the cavity dominates. So let me go back now. Remember, I kind of motivated my talk by the desire to make single photons interact. So how are these things connected? Let's consider a very simple, let's consider the same physics, but kind of from a very different perspective, which hopefully will give you a little bit of intuition. So let's consider the propagation of a focused laser beam inside the atomic medium. And let's ask, let's, you know, assume that the size of this beam is d, and let's basically ask what is a single photon, single atom interaction probability. So how to calculate this probability? So one way to think about this is to think about basically the atoms as a kind of solid balls, right, which kind of block the flow of photons in this pipe, right? So this focused laser beam is like photons flowing through this pipe. And effectively, the size, the effective size of the atom is basically given by the cross-section, right? The highest cross-section you can have for the very small like point-like atom is at resonance, of course, and this cross-section is given by lambda squared, right? That's kind of an optical theorem of quantum mechanics. So the single atom, single photon interaction probability will be basically given by effective, you know, size of the atom as seen by a photon, divided by transverse localization. So, and you know, so in general, of course, this number is much smaller than one. So you need in general a lot of atoms to absorb a photon. So that it means that, you know, to really change the propagation of a laser beam, this n should be very large. Now, let's go back to nonlinear optics. So if you would like to change the properties of the medium, how many photons will you need? So if you have n atoms which participate in interaction, to saturate all of these n atoms, you will need a kind of an order of n photons, right? So this is the number of photons which will modify this atomic response. And so what you see from this consideration is that usually when lambda squared is much smaller than d squared, then you need a lot of photons to basically saturate, to change the optical response of the system. But if, for example, we put a cavity around this this atomic cloud, what will happen is that now one photon can make multiple attempts to interact with these atoms. In fact, the number of attempts will be precisely equal to the number of round trips, which is precisely equal to the cavity finesse. In this case, this number of atoms which will be required to absorb this one photon will also require this factor 1 over f. And in fact, you know, in this case, this, you know, when f is sufficiently large, this p can be very close to 1. So in this case, just one atom can be used to block the photon. And so this is precisely the condition, you know, to have one atom interact strongly with one photon is the condition that this quantity is larger than 1. And this quantity is precisely equal to this cooperativity, is precisely equal to g squared over kappa gamma. So that's the physics we have seen. So basically, you know, this is what we will start studying in the next lecture, is a situation where if you have an atom which is basically in some way coupled to some kind of one-dimensional channels of propagating photon, such that if, for example, you excite this atom, then the photon will always go in this channel. So if you then take another atom, then this photon will almost certainly interact with this other atom. And so basically, this allows one to really kind of fully control atom-photon interactions. And these are the kinds of things which can be used to. It can be used to control spatially and spectrally spontaneous emission of the atom. It could be used to basically reversibly map quantum information between atom and photon, and back to atom. And it can also be used for single photon nonlinear optics. The reason is that if, for example, this photon is coming to this atom, you know, it will interact with that atom, and basically one photon will saturate an atom, right? Because there is only one atom here. So if I have two photons, they can interact with this atom. This atom will respond very, very differently, because the first photon will already saturate it. So the second atom will feel very different atomic response. So, and the key figure of merit, the take-home message, is that the key figure of merit is this cooperativity. It's basically, if you want the effective optical depth of one atom, that is the probability with which one incident photon will interact with this one atom. Thank you.
Thank you, Michail.